Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Spring Garden this morning as we gather together to worship. Today is Palm Sunday, a day that we celebrate, a day that the crowds welcome Jesus into Jerusalem as king. And they wave their palm branches, shouting, Hosanna. And Hosanna is a Hebrew word which means save us. And it comes from Psalm 118. So as we begin our time of worship, if you feel comfortable and you want to wave your palms around, for those of you online, you can, I don't know, you can just wave your fingers. Good idea. Anyway, so please, stand with us as we begin with a liturgy.
As Jesus entered Jerusalem riding on a donkey, a very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted,
Hosanna to the Son of David.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest heaven.
This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee.
Hosanna in the highest.
Washed away. From Psalm 118, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Open for me the gates of the righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give thanks to the Lord, for you answered me, for you have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With bows in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever.
Thank you.
Please pray with me. Jesus, we come here this morning to lift up your name, to praise you as king, but not a king like earthly kings, but a king that reigns in justice and in mercy and in grace, a king that in 5 days will die on a cross. And so, Jesus, we raise our palms and sing, Save Us, to you, also knowing that in a few days we won't be there to wave palms and to sing praises, but we, like your disciples, will be afraid, and we will turn away from you. And Lord, we know that this is part of what it is in our humanity and the sin of the world and the brokenness of life. But this is why you've come, that we could be whole, to forgive us and to heal us, to give us hope. And so God, we come before you, a worthy king who will die for us. Bringing to you those places in our weeks where we have turned away from you, those places in our weeks where we have not proclaimed you as king, but we have perhaps lifted up other things unworthy of our worship, given them priority in our lives. And so for these places of brokenness and of sin, where we have not loved you, we have not loved others, and where we've not loved your creation, we lift them to you for your forgiveness. We thank you, God, that we stand before you as forgiven people, forgiven by the work of Jesus on the cross. And so we receive this gift unearned, but out of your love for us. And so we thank you for your forgiveness, and we thank you for the peace that you offer us. Amen. Let's now, those who have received the peace of Christ, let's take a moment to pass that peace to others around us.
Good morning, everyone. It's so wonderful to be worshiping with you today. Today is a very special Sunday. We have an intergenerational worship gathering, and it's Palm Sunday. And so today the kids are gonna and the youth are gonna remain upstairs. We're gonna have a worship time all together, as we believe that the church is made up of people of all ages and stages, and it's such a beautiful opportunity for us to experience the presence of God and worship, in response to that, worship God as a community of so many different people. So, kids and youth, you will remain upstairs today. Also, there are some palms at the back if you didn't have a chance to grab one. We'll be doing an activity, tactile worship activity, intergenerational activity a little bit later. So everyone does need a palm. So if you haven't grabbed one, there are some just at the back of the worship area there on a table for you to grab. We'll also be having refreshments after worship. And so we invite you to stay, enjoy a snack, a cup of coffee or tea, and also a have a conversation with someone. It's a really good opportunity to connect. As we enter into Passion Week, we're approaching Easter very quickly, and so we have a number of different things happening around Easter that we wanted to let you know about. The first is on Thursday, March 28th, we're having a Maundy Thursday communion and prayer led by Anne Barron. And so that's going to happen online from 7:30 to 8:30. If you need the Zoom link, feel free to email me and I can share it with you. The following day, so March 29th at 10 a.m., we'll be having our Good Friday worship gathering. So we invite you to come out to that. It's going to be a really meaningful time of worship. And then on Easter Sunday, so that's March 31st, we have three things happening. So we have an Easter sunrise liturgy and communion at 6:45. So everyone who would like to come to that, we will gather at the doors by the parking lot there, and then spend some time in prayer, receiving communion, and just in worship. We'll then have our normal worship time at 10 a.m., so, but that's our Easter Sunday worship gathering, which will be obviously a really exciting and special time to celebrate Easter. And then following worship, we have an egg hunt and special Easter refreshments. And so we encourage you to stay after worship. And if you have kids, if you want to be a part of that, it's a really great opportunity for you to kind of have some fun and get some chocolate. So can't complain about that. if you're able to help with the egg hunt, please let me know. We're just looking for some volunteers to help coordinate set up and clean up and just the running of the whole hunt itself. We have a seniors event this upcoming Thursday, March 28th, from 7 to 9 p.m. There is a Chinese performing arts group that are coming in, and they would like to, they're going to put on a performance for the seniors. So if you would like to volunteer at that event, please let me know as soon as possible. We have a gym night that is coming up on April 6th, and then there is another two, one in May, so May 4th, and then one in June, that's June 8th. They happen from 7 to 9 p.m. at Westmount CI. There is a map to the school on the events page. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out to Sam, or you can just sign up using the link on the screen. The cost is $5 per person just to kind of subsidize the space, but so you can send that by e-transfer. The following day, so April 7th, we have a clothing swap that's happening after worship. And so if you are looking to do some spring cleaning, it's crazy. I thought we could put our coats away, but clearly we can't. So, but if you are looking to kind of change your closets over soon and you're wanting to go through some stuff, we're collecting women's, children's, and men's clothing, all in good condition. So there is a table in the West Lounge, just kind of as you enter over there on the left-hand side. You can leave the stuff there during the week between 9 and 3 or bring it on Sundays. We're also looking for volunteers to help with setting the clothes up so that after worship at around 11:30, when we invite everyone to go downstairs and to look through the clothes, it's all set up nicely and organized by age and maybe like different type of clothes. So if you're able to do that, please let Manuela know. Her email address is just on the screen there. There's also flyers in the West Lounge. So if you want to give one out to your neighbor to kind of encourage them to maybe go through their closet, and if you want to invite them to come, they would be welcome to as well. We have a newcomer welcome tea happening that same day, so any clothes left over from the clothing swap will kind of be left for the newcomers to have a chance to go through, which will be a really neat opportunity. But we're looking for volunteers at the newcomer event, volunteers to help us set up, table hosting, kind of helping in the kitchen, that kind of thing, so or making home-baked treats. So if you're able to serve in any of those capacities, please let me know. If you yourself are a newcomer to Canada and you want to be a part of this event, you can register using the link on the screen. For our final announcement, I'm going to invite Scott up.
Morning. I have my deacon hat on this morning, specifically representing Jeff, our finance deacon. We wanted you to know that at our congregational meeting last month, we passed our 2024 budget, a balanced budget, which just means our revenue equals our expenses, of $689,119 exactly. This is a 2.1% increase from last year's budget, which is less than inflation, so we worked hard to really manage this budget well and keep expenses in line. About 64% of those expenses are related to our staff, but it also includes costs for managing our property, our missions budget, and all the ministries that we do here. 89% of that revenue comes from donations from us as a community. So that's $616,000. And so as we continue into 2024, we appreciate your prayerful consideration of how you can be part of that budget and those donations. Thank you very much.
I'd like to invite Noah up to lead us in prayer.
Good morning, everybody. It's very good to be together today. My prayer is going to be based off of 1 Peter 5, verses 6 to 11. It's going to be in three parts. So first, I'd like to invite you all to place your hands on your lap, palms up, as we take a position of humility before God. Verses 6 and 7. We humble ourselves under your mighty hand, God, that you may lift us up in due time. We cast all our anxieties on you because you care for us. Father, you are compassionate. We come before you today in humility, many of us hurting, many of us grieving, some angry and some confused, some struggling with the pride that springs so unbidden from our hearts. In all this, we remind ourselves that you are present, you are patient, and you are powerful. You do not leave us where we are, although it may feel like you do sometimes. Lord, as a community here at Spring Garden, we are facing varied challenges, from school stress to the rising cost of living, to the increasing hostility of our culture, to the declining health of our loved ones or of ourselves. We have much to be anxious about. Teach us to focus on you. Fill the eyes of our hearts and the eyes of our minds with you and with your vision for this world. We are so in need of a Savior, God. This morning, we bring to mind those things that have become idols to us. We bring to mind the obstacles and roadblocks in our path towards you. Our fears, perhaps around health concerns or financial provision, even fears of your existence, God, we lay at your feet. Our pride, the voices in our minds that tell us we are better than our brothers and sisters, the voices that tell us we are sufficient apart from you, these lies we also lay at your feet. The many sins we commit mindlessly without even knowing it, these too we surrender to you. For all this and more, Father, forgive us, even as we strive to forgive those who sin against us. We remind ourselves in this that you care for us. Thank you, Father. We remind ourselves that in Christ you are shaping us, slowly but ever so surely, into truer bearers of your image and likeness. For part two of the prayer, I invite you to extend your hands out in a symbol of blessing and petition for those around us. Verses 8 and 9. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. Father God, this morning, we pray for the global church. In particular, I'd like to pray for our brothers and sisters in Haiti, Sudan, Gaza, Ukraine, and Russia. We pray that you would fill them with your Holy Spirit, providing them with sober minds and steadfast hearts. We ask that they would continue to be lights shining in the darkness of where they are. God of grace, may your name be known, may it be loved, and may it be feared, even in the pain-filled corners of this planet. God of salvation, we come boldly before you, wearing the blood of your Son, and we ask that you would bring peace and order to these places of strife and instability. Your kingdom come, Father, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Last, I invite you to raise your hands above your head as we praise our God together. And God of all grace, you called us to your eternal glory in Christ, and after we have suffered a little while, you yourself will restore us and make us strong, firm, and steadfast. To you, O Lord, be the power forever and ever. Amen. Thank you.
Thanks, Noah. I invite you, if you're able, to stand with us as we continue to worship Jesus, our King.
Our scripture reading this morning is from John 13, verses 1 to 17. And that can be found on page 874 of your Bibles in the pews.
It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end.
The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him.
He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?"
Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand."
"No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet."
Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me."
"Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well."
Jesus answered, "Those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you."
For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place.
"Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them."
This is the word of the Lord.
All right, boys and girls, if you're a child, I want to invite you to come up to the front so we could chat a bit. Yeah, come up. Let's come and sit at the steps so we could chat. So how is everyone? Good? Yeah. I had a question for you. What comes to your mind when you think of a king or a queen? What are some like pictures that come to your mind if of a king or a queen? Yeah. Napoleon, yeah. That's a very specific king, yes. And what does the king wear, Evan? Right, he's wearing nice clothes, and I think Napoleon would have been, what kind of, would he have been on some kind of horse, yeah, right? The finest horse, right? It's like a big war horse, right? Who is, because Napoleon was known as a good, I think, king in that sense, right? What would, yes?
Queen Elizabeth I, that's who I
Oh, that's who you picture, right, yeah? Yeah, I mean, she was a queen for so long, right? And she was our queen as part of, you know, we're part of the Commonwealth, right? Would they live in a castle, you think?
Yes.
Yeah, right? They would live in a big castle, right? Would probably have a nice car, right? Would they have a nice car, you think?
Depends,
yeah. Possibly, yeah. I mean, I think they have a queen's, like, they have a car made for the queen in the past. But, all right. Well, here's a picture of a king that I wanted us to look at. This picture of King Charles. And this was the coronation. So this is part of when King Charles, you know, after Queen Elizabeth passed away, and then King Charles became the king. So this is like the procession, right? And see that buggy there? That was the car that that the king was on or in. And he broke tradition. So there was a more older carriage or a coach that he could have ridden, but he broke tradition and rode this other one called, this one's called the Diamond Jubilee State Coach. And the reason why they chose that one, because it has a nice suspension system. Whereas the other one was very, like, it's hard on the body, right? And it also has electric windows and an air conditioning, right? All these things which are important, which the other, I think, coach didn't have. And so they wanted to ride in style, but also in comfort, right? So it's called the Diamond Jubilee State Coach. And you know how many people came? All these people came to watch them, to see them process down, to go and get, to become the king. It was called the coronation, where they put the crown on the king's head as a way to symbolize now he is the official king. And there were over 2,000 people at this church where he became the king, and over 200 people from 200 countries came to experience this. Do you think these people were just regular people? Like, I think our prime minister was there, right? And there were other, like, dignitaries, so people who are, like, important came to this coronation. And normal people wouldn't be able to go in to this kind of thing, right? Like, it was a special event, and so you had to be pretty important in order to go. Well, and if you were to have met the king, how would you address them? What would you say? Would you say, like, my liege, or my lord, or you just say my king or my queen? What would you say? Yes?
I'd just say, hey, the king's name.
Yeah, hey, king. Hey, Charles. You'd be like, hey, Charles, what's up? Yeah. Well, did you know there's a thing called, they have an etiquette expert in England? Yeah, etiquette just means, like, I guess manners, you know how you say please and thank you, that kind of stuff. But with important people like the king and the queen, you have to have manners too, right? So you can't just say, hey, Charles, right? What you would normally say is your highness.
Or your majesty.
Yeah, or sir or ma'am, right? And you have to do like a curtsy to a woman. And to a man, you have to kind of like dip your head. And a few other things you can't do is, you can't be the first one to put your hand out. You have to wait for the king or the queen to first say, hey, I want to shake your hand. Then you could shake their hand.
Yes, I know it.
You know about this? Oh.
Why do you have to wait for the king or queen to do it?
Well, because they're, I guess, more important than us. So so we have to wait for them to do it. Another thing you can't do is you can't walk in front of the king. Yeah, you have to always stay behind the king. The king has to be in the front because, you know, he's more important, right, kind of thing. And you can't hug him or you can't show your back to the king. Those are a few other things you couldn't do. Yeah, so there's all these kind of like manners and rules. Because the king is so important, we want to show them respect and honor and all of this. Does anyone know what today is, this Sunday? We are all carrying,
Easter.
We're close to Easter, and we all have something that we're waving.
Palm Sunday.
Palm, right? And we do the Palm Sunday. Why do we do that? Do you know why we do that? Because it's Palm Sunday, yeah. Yeah, it's true. But the reason why we do it too is because Jesus was entering into Jerusalem.
I know.
And then he was doing something like King Charles, where it was like a procession into the city. And people started waving palms to say, look, oh, this king is coming. This King Jesus is coming. Kind of like King Charles. When King Charles was processing, all these people were there. I think they were saying tens of thousands of people were there waving flags, right? Like, and saying, hey, look, right? But so this is a picture of Jesus, something like this. This isn't a real picture of Jesus, but it's like what we think would have been like. So, you know, there are people on the side, they're waving their palms, and Jesus is coming in on a donkey. So a very big difference from King Charles, right, who was in that chariot, versus Jesus coming in on a donkey. And I don't think there would have been a lot of important people there, nor would have a lot of people known about Jesus was coming in. But the people who were there were just normal people who saw Jesus coming in, and they were saying, Hosanna, you know, and they're singing and waving their palms.
What does Hosanna even mean?
It means praise the Lord. It's like praise God kind of thing. Yeah. So let me read you, John talks about this event where Jesus came into Jerusalem and people were waving palm branches and worshiping Jesus, saying, hey, this is the new king that we've been waiting for. And John says it was in a prophet, Zechariah, who actually talked about this king who was going to come. So it's going to be on the screen. Let me read it for you. And this is what it says in Zechariah 9:9. It says, rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem, see your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. So Jesus comes as a different king. Napoleon would have come in on a like a big war horse, but Jesus comes in on this little donkey that's not a war horse, right? And it actually says, Zechariah says, he comes in lowly and riding on a donkey, and that's what happens. So Jesus comes as a different kind of king, not like King Charles who comes with all the fanfare, with all these important people, but he comes into Jerusalem as a humble king, a king who is humble. So what we're going to do now is we're going to have you go back to your seats. I have some coloring pages for you to take before you go. And there are crayons at tables. So everyone take one. And then what we're going to do as well, this will be for you to do afterwards, but what we're all going to do together is we're going to make a palm cross. Okay? Here. Everyone take that.
Well, I was trying to make that.
Yeah, we're going to make one. So you could take one of these two. Do you want to take this as an example? All right. So, yeah, you could take one. Do you want to take it, see if anyone else wants it? Yeah. Evan, take a few and see if people want it, kids want it. Yeah, here. And give it out. Yeah, yeah. Take it. And so the rest of us, too, what we're going to do now is actually make a palm cross. And so we'll watch a video to see how to make it. And then we'll give you a few minutes to actually make the palm cross. There's also instructions that will be there afterwards for some of you who need a little more time. And then if you also need more instructions, it's on a QR code on our order of worship, so that's another spot to look at. But let's watch the video. Yeah, and we could keep up this up there for a little bit for you. If you walk away from this morning, at least you would have learned something, right? Beyond the... So I want to go back to talking about etiquette. One of the etiquettes in the times of Jesus is that when you entered into someone's house, if you went over to someone's house as a guest, they would have a wash basin there to wash people's feet, right? Because back then the roads weren't as they are now, and so washing feet was a very hygienic thing to do. But it was some, it was a way of being hospitable as well, is that you would have a place where people can wash their feet. And if you were rich, you would have slaves who would do that for you, for the guests, right? They would come and wash your feet before you enter the home. But for regular people, the host would provide water so that the guests could wash their own feet. The host would never wash the guest's feet, but would just provide that service, you know, that it was a way of being hospitable. But the host would never do it because it's too demeaning. It's only for, you know, slaves and servants to do, not for the host to do. To wash someone's feet was to mean that you were at that same level as a slave, and so it wasn't done by people who had some level of class. So we see in this story that the disciples are at a Passover dinner meal. And the verse 2 states that while the evening meal was in progress, while the dinner was happening, Jesus got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and started to wash the feet of the disciples. What is weird about this event is that, first of all, that no one has actually washed their feet yet before they sat down to even have this meal. Just as we would wash our hands before we would go and have a meal, especially these days, it would be weird for the disciples have to have not washed their feet before they've sat down for this meal together. But no one had done it, and they were eating. They were already, the meal was already in progress. And I never noticed this before, but the reason, the possible reason why Jesus had to wash their feet, well, the feet of the disciples, was that because no one wanted to stoop down low enough to wash each other's feet, or even to provide, go and grab a basin of water to wash the disciples' feet. And the reason why they didn't want to do this is because none of them wanted to seem like they were lower than the other person. Because if you were to do that, it meant that maybe you weren't as, you know, on equal level. And we know this to be true because in Luke's account of this story, we see that during the meal, the disciples are fighting over who's better than the other. Who is going to be the greatest in the kingdom of God, of kingdom, this new kingdom of Jesus that they are part of. So it makes sense to me that none of the disciples wanted to stoop that low to do that because they're already fighting over who's better than the other. So people are eating with dirty feet, equivalent to eating with dirty hands because the disciples were too proud. So when Jesus gets up and starts washing the disciples' feet, everyone would have been looking at each other thinking, what is going on here? What is Jesus doing? They would have been speechless, not knowing how to respond to such an audacious act. When we see this as Peter reacts to what Jesus was doing, John 13, 6, 8, he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus replied, you do not realize what I am doing, but later you will understand. No, said Peter, you shall never wash my feet. Peter uses the title of Jesus and says to him, Lord, in Greek, which means kurios, that is my master. You are going to wash my feet? No, never, Jesus. Never to all eternity shall you wash my feet. How can you, who is my master, but also the Messiah, the king who is supposed to set us free from the captivity of the Roman rule, how can you, who is much greater than me, swoop down so low to do such a thing that none of us wanted to do in this room? How can you do such a thing that only slaves do? And Jesus knew that the disciples wouldn't understand, that Peter wouldn't understand, because to do such a thing was against what they understood as power of influence, what people who are messiahs or kings would have done. The disciples did not understand how the king Messiah would do such a thing because they still have not understood that Jesus has come to die on the cross, They have not understood that this King Jesus, this Messiah, was not going to wash their feet, but would enter, not only wash their feet, but would enter death itself, not just any kind of death, but death of a criminal, a death of a traitor, the worst kind of death reserved for the worst kind of people. He did this to redeem and to save all people and creation. Verse 3, Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. Why does Jesus wash the disciples' feet? John says that Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power. Jesus already knew that he was God and knew that he had power. Jesus didn't have to worry about losing his power or that someone was going to take away his power. He was secure in his own power that he was able to wash the feet of his disciples. He had nothing to prove about who he was, but can be, and so can readily enter into the place of servanthood precisely because he had power. We're in a series called Divesting Divinity, where we're looking at the self-emptying of Jesus. Jesus doesn't divest his power in that he has lost his power. Rather, through his self-emptying, he has shown us how to use our power as a form of empowering. Jesus didn't give up power, rather he gave out power. By his self-emptying, power is rightly used in empowering others. There's a professor in Vancouver School of Theology named Sally McFaggy. She writes that we can see in the Trinity of God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit that in their relationship of love towards one another, that we see the self-emptying as empowerment. The self-emptying of Jesus is the empowering love of God. The self-emptying of Jesus is the empowering love of God. Some of you may have heard this quote by Lord Acton, that power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Andy Crouch, in his book, Playing God, says that power isn't actually evil, but can be used for good. It's not that power in itself is evil, but what we do with power leads to evil. He asks the questions, though, how are parents then able to use their power that leads to flourishing? A parent who loves their child has absolute power over their infant, especially when they're infants. You made that? Amazing. What are we going to do with it? Dad is making that, yes. Awesome. Right? In many ways, an infant baby is very vulnerable. They can't do anything on their own. And the parent or the child, the caregiver, has absolute power over this infant. Yet they're not corrupted in their power. And, you know, we know that there are some caregivers who aren't as good as others. But usually, they are able to use their power for good. In fact, every one of you in this room is alive because someone who had absolute power over your life took care of you. So we see an example where power is used for good. And he says, why does a parent do this? Why can a parent use their power for good? Is because of love. Because love transfigures power. Love is able to use power in a positive way. It uses power for good. And this is the line that Crouch House has on power that I really like. He says, absolute love transfigures absolute power. Absolute love transfigures absolute power. In a similar way, but not in the same way, because God is much more greater than we are. God is much more loving than we are, right? God is love. We sometimes think we as parents when we say that God, like a parent, loves us. But in some sense, we, like God, love others, right? Because we believe that God is love. God is the source of love. He's the one that who created love. He is the one that loves. So God's love is much greater than ours, right? So we can't think of it in the opposite, where we say God's love is like a father or a mother's love for their child. In fact, it's the opposite, right? In terms of, yes, like a love a parent has, but unlike us, he is not corrupt. Unlike us, he's not insecure of who he is. Unlike us, he doesn't need to prove anything to anybody. He is secure in his own power. Yet because he loves us and he has absolute love, he can then use power for good. And he does this by washing the feet of his disciples. He says, "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am." He is still teacher and Lord. "Now that your Lord and teacher have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you." Jesus is still teacher and Lord. He didn't give up who he was, but rather in his love for us, he transfigured what it means to be teacher and Lord. A king who washes feet has shown us how love leads to using power, not to rule over others, but rather to empower others. True power leads to multiplication of power and flourishing for all people. So what does this mean for us who are to follow a king who washes feet and calls us to do the same? How is Jesus calling us now to wash one another's feet? I think one thing we need to be aware of is that maybe we need to literally wash one another's feet. Have you ever washed someone's feet? I mean, I guess if you're a parent or a caregiver, you may have washed like your kids' feet and other parts, right, that are worse. But to wash a stranger's feet, wash a underhoused person's feet. One thing I love about Out of the Cold program, I don't know if anyone of you heard of this program, is where they provide a safe space in the winter for people who are homeless or underhoused to have a place to stay. But as part of that program, one of the things they do is wash people's feet. Because one thing that underhoused people struggle with most is their feet hygiene. Because they're usually on their feet all day. And so that's part of their body that needs to be taken care of, or they have sores and it leads to other kind of problems. And so washing feet is a very important part, and foot care is a very important part for underhoused people. So people literally wash feet. And I believe that Jesus says right here, we should wash one another's feet. There are a few things we call sacraments in the church or ordinances, things that Jesus has commanded us to do. So one is baptism, right? The other is communion. And I think washing feet is up there. We don't normally practice it, but I think it's almost up there. I don't want to say it's a sacrament because that's not been the tradition of the church, but I think it's up there. I think it's sacramental. The other part of washing feet is not only is it humbling to wash someone's feet. Have you ever been washed? Have you ever had your foot being washed by someone else? I've had that experience once at a foot washing worship gathering where I had to sit and someone had to wash my feet. And that in itself is a humbling experience. It's really, right, like for someone to be touching your feet and washing it, it is a very intimate an awkward kind of experience to have. But to be willing to let someone wash your feet is also a humbling experience. And so I think it is something to practice. But there's obviously the literal piece of washing feet, but what about the symbolic act of washing feet? How do we be people who, like Jesus, we're not falsely giving up our power, saying, I'm humbling myself to wash someone's feet. But rather, because we are secure in who we are, in our love that God has for us, then we can enter into washing other people's feet and then show and do that as a way of empowering. So how can we who have power and influence wash another person's feet? To me, it's a way of empowering. So we give out power, not because we lose power, not because we lose status, but it's a way of empowering others so that they can also flourish. I want to end our time today with that question of what does it mean for you then to wash one another's feet? What might God be calling you to wash one another's feet? And as we spend some time praying afterwards, what we'll do is we'll take the palm cross and Greg will give more directions of what will happen with that. But I think even just to think about the palm cross, right? The palm was used as a way of a procession of Jesus coming in as the king, as a humble king. And we wave the palm as a way, as a sign of saying, Hosanna, you are the king. Yet it's a cross. So it's the king who dies on a cross. To me, that shows this humble, this empowering God who dies on the cross so that we can have life. So let's pray. Jesus, we thank you that you are a king who doesn't give up power, but rightly uses power. That in your love for us, that you use power for good, to more flourishing, to empowerment, where we can be your hands and feet in this world. And we take a moment now, Jesus, to reflect on what you might be saying to us, of what it means for us to wash one another's feet. Jesus, you are a humble king. I'm picturing you washing the feet of the disciples, but also washing our own feet. Are we able to let you do that? Help us to accept your love for us, that you've shown us how to serve, how to empower others out of love. So may we respond to your call, your command to go and do likewise. As you've set an example for us, we pray that you would give us that power, that ability to wash one another's feet. In Jesus' name, amen.
How many of us were successful in making a cross? A few? One thing the lady forgot to tell us is a trick is, and if you want to take your palms home and try more, the trick is splitting your palm in half so that it's thinner to start. I see a few people being like, oh my goodness. Anyway, I just found that out, so. The one way that we wanted to give an opportunity for response is if... is if you wanted to, we've got paper clips over at the front, and we thought for those, if you managed to make a cross and you would like to kind of as a symbol of walking in this humility of a king who goes to the cross for us and is an image of Christ as our king as a church. If you want to hang your cross, go over and hang it on with one of the clips onto those white frames over there. Have lines across that you can hang it on, and so it's to be an image of and a reminder to us. But if you worked really hard on that one cross and you're like, no way, I'm not leaving that here, you're welcome to keep it. There are about 12 crosses pre-made that are over there. And if you would like to if you weren't able to make one, you're welcome to go and hang up one of those crosses. All this being said, I invite you, if you're able as well, to stand with us as we're going to offer ourselves to this humble king.
You are the one looking.
Jesus, we thank you that you've shown us a different way. And Lord, we so easily get caught up in the pomp and circumstance, like King Charles and Napoleon, and we get drawn in. And we get drawn in a way that we believe the lie that they are important people and we aren't. And Lord, in the cross, you came low. You became one from a borderland town. To the lowest of humanity in the eyes of humanity as God. And we ask, God, that you would help us, that you would change the ways that we view the world. You would give us new lenses, that we would see the way that you see. That we would not only know our value, Lord, but that we would not raise up others in ways that are unhealthy, and we would not raise up ourselves in ways that are unhealthy. Jesus, you are the God of broken, of the weak, of the weary, of those in need. We thank you that you come, you wash our feet, that you kneel before us when we should be kneeling before you. We ask, Lord, that this would help us and would shape us, that we would be people who kneel before others and not seek that others would kneel before us. You are our King, you are our Lord. Hosanna, save us. Amen. As we go with one more song, as part of our worship is offering ourselves to God. And so if you are wanting to worship through giving a financial offering, there are QR codes in the pews. There's an email on the screen as well as a box in the back. You're welcome to worship that way, and as we as a community participate in the ministry that God's called us to together. If you're a visitor with us, we do hope you feel no obligation to give. It's a gift to have you with us, and so we do hope that you, no one feels any obligation to give financially. And let's sing together.
Take the
And now, as we always do with the kids, if you want to, as a sign of receiving the blessing, if you want to hold your hands out like you are catching water, perhaps water poured from a basin, you can do that. And then, as a symbol of blessing, I'll put my hand up. For those of you who don't know, we usually do this with the children earlier, so it makes sense if, yeah. So now, as you go into your week, may Jesus, the humble King, whose arms were spread wide on the cross to embrace the whole world, may he be with you this week by the power of the Holy Spirit and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ as we move towards the cross and through the cross to resurrection. Amen. God bless.